Welcome to video podcast number 6, which is actually a day or two early. I was originally going to do this podcast on either tomorrow or Thursday, but tomorrow I saw my schedule, I'm going to be pretty busy. And Thursday, you know, I didn't want to go that many days without doing one. So I'm coming 2 days later from my last podcast. Got good news to report. Not that views are everything, but remember in my very last video podcast, I was mentioning that for video podcast number 4, I had over 17,000 views. Now that particular video podcast has over 50,000 views. That is way above my expectations. Way above my expectations. I did not expect that at all. Because I'm happy anytime I break 10,000. If I break 10,000, or even really sometimes if I break 5,000 views, I'm happy. But yeah, video podcast number 4 has over 50,000 views. And I think my very last video, video podcast number 5, has over 10,000 views. So I'm appreciative of every man and woman that has taken time to check out my video podcast. I'm going to reiterate, I'm not going to be doing video podcasts like some guys on YouTube. Like, there's some guys, like my man, Angry Man. Angry Man, man, he be putting out like 2, 3, 4 video podcasts per day. Same with O'Shea Duke Jackson. A lot of times he puts out 2 or 3 video podcasts per day. And I know a lot of other video podcasts, at minimum, they do 1 per day. Man, I'm not on that level. And I don't have the schedule and free time to be on that level. Because I remember when I did my Blog Talk Radio show, I only did 1 audio podcast per week. Now, that one show would usually be very long. Like I mentioned in one of my previous video podcasts, I had some episodes of my audio podcast on Blog Talk Radio that would range anywhere from 2.5 hours to 4 hours. So each episode was very long, but I only did my episodes once per week. I never did 2 episodes per week or 3 episodes per week. Like, I know some people on Blog Talk Radio, they do a show every day. But yeah, the most I think you'll probably ever see out of me in the upcoming weeks on YouTube is maybe 3 video podcasts in a single week. Most weeks, I'm going to only produce 1 or 2 video podcasts per week. 1 or 2 video podcasts per week. Now, see, I'm still being nitpicky over somebody who tried to tease me. And it was lighthearted. It wasn't nothing serious. But some woman tried to say that I had a S curl or something. Now, I want you to, I'm trying to put, can you see my hair? What about, now you can see, matter of fact, on top, you can see where it's thinning out. My hair is thinning out big time as I've gotten older. Matter of fact, I'm sure in about 2, 3, 4 years, I'm probably going to have this major receding hairline on like the front half or front third of the top of my head. That's why I've been wearing some hats, though, man. I don't like the way my webcam captures my hairline. It makes it look, I mean, I already got a receding hairline compared to when I was young, but the webcam makes it look way back, way back. But no escrow in here, baby. Matter of fact, I should go grab a picture of my father. I have one I was looking at the other day. But again, my father, man, he got like that, you know, he had that white boy wavy hair, man. He, you know, he didn't have no thick hair. But anyway, enough about my hair. As normal, I'm going to start off with a few shout outs. Well, I shouldn't say as normal. I only did this in the last episode, but I'm going to do it again. I used to do this when I did my audio podcast on Blog Talk Radio. I like to give certain shout outs. So when people leave a comment in the comment section below, I give shout outs. Here's my shout outs for video podcast number 6. W. Bradley, I appreciate you watching my videos and commenting on my videos. Aaron James, I appreciate you. Fast Attack Tough, I appreciate you. The Naive Beta Male, I like that username. That's my biggest demographic. I mean, let's keep it real. My biggest demographic, people who buy most of my books, guys who pay for most of my email consultations, my Skype and telephone consultations, and my one-on-one face-to-face coaching sessions are men who are naive beta males. Excuse me, my eyelashes. Something always messing with me on my face, man. Remember the last video podcast I did? My nose start itching. Now it's my eyelashes. I mean, what's up? But yeah, naive beta males. I mean, quite frankly, I don't really have any clients that come to me saying, yo, Al, man, I've been a womanizing alpha male for the last 15 years. And, you know, now I'm having problems. I've had a few, though. I won't say I haven't had any. I've had some guys that have come to me for advice that were self-proclaimed players and womanizers, and they just wanted to kind of what I call fine-tune or tweak their game a bit. But most of the guys who come to me are guys who fall in the category of naive beta males. Remember, for the most part, it's not your fault if you're a naive beta male. Don't beat yourself up over being a self-proclaimed beta male. The reason, the number one reason why you are a naive, ignorant beta male is because you were fed invalid and faulty social programming. Remember that. You were fed, your mind was fed invalid. It's just like having two computers. Like, for example, a Mac computer operates on a totally different operating system than a Windows PC. They have different operating systems. So you can think of the operating system of a computer as being representative of that computer's social programming. And your mind is like a human computer, man. If you fed the wrong information, it's going to produce fault, you know, undesirable results. And again, there's my nose itching again. You know, I have specific differences between the personality and behavior traits of a womanizing alpha male versus a naive beta male. But if I had to just generally say what's the difference, is your social programming. So anyway, going back to this particular YouTube commenter, his username was the Naive Beta Male. For Life One Deeps. No, I'm sorry. For Life One Deep One. For Life One Deep One. I appreciate you. Edward Coleman. I went to high school with a guy named Edward Coleman. But I don't think this is the same guy. But a guy named Edward Coleman. He commented on my YouTube, my last YouTube podcast. I appreciate it. Eric King. Black Euro Strikes. That's my man. Black Euro Strikes. He recommend, you know, I'm big on my vitamin zero water. So wait. Do I have it in the camera right? Okay. Yeah. He recommended this flavor. Dragon fruit. Matter of fact, on camera, this will be my first time tasting. This is one of the few flavors I've never tasted of vitamin water zero. Now, there's some flavors of the regular vitamin water they have that I haven't tasted, but I don't want to use the one that has sugar in it. As you know, because I'm trying to reverse type 2 diabetes, I try to limit my sugar intake. So I only drink beverages that have very little, if any, sugar. My main artificial sweetener is called stevia extract. That's considered the best artificial sweetener out there. I tell you the worst, don't ever drink anything with aspartame in it. Oh my God. Hey, I ain't no health and nutritionist, certified nutritionist or anything like that, but I'm telling you, just real talk. Don't, if you like to drink like diet beverages, do not drink anything with aspartame. Man, that gave me so many headaches. Do your research on aspartame. That's all I'm going to say. Do your research on aspartame. But Black Euro Strikes, man. Again, man, he hooked me up with Vitamin Zero Dragon Fruit. I'm going to taste it for the first time now. Excuse me. All right, Black Euro. You the man. You the motherfucking man. Big props to you. Fist bump for that recommendation. That shit's good. Cosmic Moore. Cosmic Moore, I appreciate you. James Leffel. Now, James Leffel, he was bold enough to admit that he's been a habitual fun clubber for a lot of his adult life. He pretends like he's content with being a woman's friend, but he really wants to fuck him. That's fun clubbing. That's what I call fun clubbing, a term that's now internationally popular. I've been using that term since like my freshman year in college. Older frat brother of mine first told me about that term, fun clubbing. But now he claims in his comments, in my comment section, that he his fun clubbing sometimes has benefited him because he's fucked a few of his fun club partners. Hey, still, I am adamantly against fun clubbing. Because here's my thing with fun clubbing. Even if you get the pussy, it's going to take you a long time to get it. It's going to take you weeks, months, years. Man, if you got that type of time to invest, more power to you. That's all I'll say. More power to you. Young Ciola, she's probably my most consistent female commenter. Young Ciola, old school brother, man. He commented, I don't know if he commented in my comment section, but he wrote a comment. He used to listen to my Blog Talk Radio audio podcast. And he wrote a comment giving me kudos. Matter of fact, just yesterday, a guy by the name of Lance Diamond Rivera. I think his name is Lance Diamond Rivera. He asked me, was I ever going to do Blog Talk Radio again? No. Never, ever. I've called into Obsidian's live radio show on Blog Talk Radio, so if there's one show I tend to call in and contribute to, it would be probably Obsidian's Blog Talk Radio show, but I'll never host a show again. I did that for 9 years. 9 years. That's long enough. I did the Blog Talk Radio audio podcast thing for 9 years, and I have no interest in doing it again. The closest for me to doing Blog Talk Radio again is what you're seeing right now on YouTube. You know, these video podcasts. There might be a time in the future where I might do video interviews with guests, you know, especially if I'm traveling or something in another city like New York, Los Angeles, Miami, whatever. But no, I'll never do Blog Talk Radio again. Also, shout out to Brooklyn Taylor. Brooklyn Taylor, he commented in that same Facebook post. Again, if you ever want to give me feedback publicly, right below in the comments section. That's for public feedback. If you want to give me more private feedback on one or more of the video podcasts you watch, you can write me email youtube@mode1.net. That's MODEONE.net. You can write me through inbox messages on one of two of my Facebook pages. I got a public figure Facebook page that goes just by Alan Roger Curry. And my personal Facebook page is author Alan Roger Curry. Now, it's funny, speaking of private feedback, I mentioned once before that probably 80 to 90% of the private feedback I receive is usually from women. men, if they have something to say about my audio podcast or my video podcast, the vast majority of the time they're going to comment in the comment section. But women, a lot of women, with the exception of Young Ciola, maybe one or two others, most women, they send me feedback privately, and they had issue, as expected, no surprise. They had issue with a couple things I said in the last podcast. Most notably, a lot of women wrote me and said, "Alan, I never thought I'd see the day where you would promote the double standard that society promotes regarding men's promiscuity versus women's promiscuity." Okay, let me make this clear. Let me make this crystal clear. A lot of people refer to the difference in attitudes and beliefs towards men's promiscuity versus women's promiscuity as a double standard. But that's not really truly accurate. See, a true double standard has legal undertones, or at minimum, very religious undertones. That would be a double standard. For example, if it was legal for men to have sex with a female prostitute, but it was illegal for women to have sex with a male prostitute, that would be a true double standard. Okay? If it was legal for men to have sex with a woman other than their wife while they're married, but it was illegal for a woman to have sex with someone other than her husband while she's married, that would be a true double standard. Double standard. When it comes to just attitudes towards shit, that ain't no true double standard. And I mentioned this in my book, The Beta Male Revolution. Speaking of my books, quick segue before I continue this thought, this opinion, commentary. Number one, my books are always available on Amazon.com. My audiobooks are available on Audible.com. Check this out. My newly revised Kindle ebook, the newly revised version of Mo 1, I got a note just late last night from Amazon saying that your Kindle ebook is missing like 4 chapters. How the fuck did that happen? I wonder if I got some hacker attacking my damn Kindle ebook. How the fuck does like just 4 chapters just go missing? That's some strange shit, man. So anyway, I had to upload it again. So if you go on the Amazon page, you're probably going to see this note saying this Kindle ebook is temporarily unavailable. And that's because I had to upload the whole Kindle ebook again. It should be ready by tomorrow morning, tomorrow afternoon. I'd say tomorrow night at the latest. That shit pissed me off. Now, back to this whole double standard thing. Wait, quick intermission. Excuse me. Dragon fruit. Here's the deal, man. Women call men sluts all the time. I've been called a slut pretty much my whole entire adult life. Women have called me a man whore. What's the difference? The difference is I don't give a fuck. And most men don't give a fuck. If you call a man a slut or a whore, it's not that men are not called names when they're promiscuous. It's that we don't give a fuck. That's the difference. We don't give a fuck. Women give a fuck. For obvious reasons. The reasons why women give a fuck, there's 2 main reasons why women give a fuck about being called, about being labeled either a slut, a whore, or an easy lay. There's two primary reasons why women care about that more than men. Number one, most men, even if they have a highly promiscuous past, that's not going to prevent them from finding a wife. I mean, there's not too many women that are going to say, I'm not going to marry Joe because Joe has slept with 50 women. I mean, you might have a few women who, like, I don't know, who are really prudish, deeply religious, that might be turned off by a guy who slept with most women. But generally speaking, women don't get turned off by a man's promiscuity. Matter of fact, I would say in most cases, it's just the opposite. Women get turned on when they know you fucked a lot of women. Because that means that a lot of women found you sexually desirable, and secondly, it means you know how to handle your business in bed. So women get turned on when a man has fucked a lot of women. But men are different, man. A lot of men, I'm not going to go over this whole thing again, stuff I talked about in my previous video podcast, but just remember Dr. Sigmund Freud's Madonna Horror Complex. Men like having casual sex with promiscuous women, women who are very open-minded and free-spirited. But a lot of men, they don't want to marry a woman who has a highly promiscuous past. Because, I mean, think about it. If you're a man and you walk into a party with your wife and there's 25 guys in that party who done had their dick in your wife's mouth or pussy or ass, I mean, how you gonna take pride in that shit? I mean, seriously though, real talk. How you gonna take pride in that? Having guys looking at you snickering like, damn, that dude's wife, man, I fucked her in the ass like 3 months ago. Now, again, there's a lot of brothers, not just brothers, a lot of guys who are very open-minded, free-spirited. They don't really care about the fact that their wife has had sex with, and more power to those guys, more power to them. I mean, there's women who are porno stars who are married. There's definitely women. I mean, again, Kim Kardashian, man, she made a public sex tape and she's been married 3 times. So a lot of times promiscuity doesn't necessarily prevent a woman from getting married in today's society. But generally speaking, man, I just know how men think. Matter of fact, a movie recommendation. If you've never seen this movie with Ben Affleck called Chasing Amy, I mentioned it in my original Mo 1 ebook and Mo 1 paperback. Man, you got to see that movie, man, if you're a movie buff. I love movies. That's if not the best, at minimum, that's in the top two, top three best movies I've seen about men's negative reactions to a woman's promiscuous past. Man, that's a damn, you gotta watch that movie. Again, it's called Chasing Amy. Matter of fact, the writer and director of that movie, Kevin Smith, he has a copy of Mo 1. But yeah, man, that movie, that was one of Ben Affleck's first movies. And I'm not gonna spoil it to you, give you too many spoilers in the movie, but if I have to give you one plot line, it's about a guy played by Ben Affleck. He meets this woman and he falls for her and they start dating. And at first it seemed like everything going well until he runs into two of her high school classmates and they basically tell him, they like, man, your girlfriend, man, she used to be a big ass freak in high school, man. Like we used to run a train on her, man. And Ben Affleck, man, he can't handle that shit, man. And that shit is real, man. That's why I love that movie, because that's real. Most guys, man, like, when it comes to a woman that's just a guy's fuck buddy or his casual sex lover, that's when men really don't care about what a woman has done with other guys. We could give a fuck. But when a woman is our long-term girlfriend or our fiance or our wife, man, a lot of guys' ego, man, cannot handle hearing that, like, that woman sucked 3 guys' dicks at the same time or like, had a threesome with 2 guys or some of that nature, man. Most guys, the average guy, can't their ego can't handle that. So, All that to say, again, going back to this theme about double standards, man, yeah, there is, in terms of attitude-wise, there is a double standard. But my thing is this. Women, don't blame men because you all aren't turned off by promiscuous men. That's your fault. That's your fault that you're not turned off by men with promiscuous pasts. It ain't our fault. It just so happens, again, for all the reasons I've already explained. Men react differently to a woman's promiscuous past, generally speaking. Again, there's always exceptions. But generally speaking, men react differently to a woman's promiscuous past if they look at, if they're looking at that woman as being a long-term girlfriend, fiance, wife. Now, speaking of that, I do use this term a lot, boyfriend, girlfriend, because it's been so common. But let me just speak on that for a second. Those terms are bullshit, okay? Make a note of that. Write it down if you have to. The terms boyfriend, girlfriend, that don't mean shit. In the big scheme of things, the only relationship title that matters is husband and wife or fiance, fiance. Other than those two titles, all the other titles don't mean shit. It's just a very, dude, I could meet a woman tomorrow named Felicia. And I could tell Felicia, hey, for the next 6 months, I want to be your boyfriend. And she says, okay, Alan, I want to be your girlfriend. If we never end up getting married or end up even engaged to be married, what do those two titles really mean? They don't mean shit. That's what they mean. They don't mean shit. The only reason, I'm going to tell you the two reasons why people use those terms, usually young people, boyfriend, girlfriend. Men like to call a woman their girlfriend to send out a message to other guys that I don't want you trying to fuck my girlfriend. That's basically what that is on the male end, is that it's a territorial thing. You trying to tell other men, I don't want you to fuck my, try to fuck my girlfriend. But here's the reality. If your girlfriend wants to give one of these other guys some pussy, she's going to give it to him. Either you know she's gonna do it behind your back, unless you give her the freedom. You have like an open relationship and you give her the freedom to fuck other guys. But hey, man, here's another message for you United Beta males. Grown people are gonna do what the fuck they want to do. Believe that shit. Grown ass man and a grown ass woman are gonna do what the fuck they want to do. If a woman runs across a guy who gets her pussy wet and she wants to fuck him, guess what? She gonna fuck him. She gonna fuck him. The only exception is if she thinks she got way too much to lose. Like, say she married to some guy who's just a multimillionaire, and she's scared that if this multimillionaire gives her, finds out she's fucking other guys, she's gonna lose that type of lifestyle. But see, in today's society, with the way divorce laws are and shit, women get paid anyway. If they get divorced, they're gonna get paid. So what difference does it make? But man, grown ass people gonna do what the fuck they want to do. Believe that. So yeah, on that double standard, man, that, women, that's your fault. Don't blame us, man. Don't try to lay no guilt trip on men. So all you women sending me these emails and inbox messages talking about, Alan, you promoting a double standard. No, I'm not. I'm not promoting a double standard. I was just giving real talk on the nature of promiscuous women. And again, the simple reality, I said it in the last video podcast, and now I'm repeating it in this video podcast. The simple reality about promiscuity as relates to women is this. If you're a woman who's had sex with a lot of guys, say starting with the age of 15, 16, 17, 18, it has the potential. I'm not going to say it definitely will hurt you, but it has the potential to hurt your chances of getting a marriage proposal from a guy. That's why most women hide their sexual past from men, because they know that. Deep down, women know that. They know that their sexual past has the potential to, because again, man, the way men think, man, Man don't want to wife a woman up and then be at some social function and have 15 guys looking at them smirking and snickering like, dude, look at that. Check that dude out with his wife, man. You see that dude's wife, man? I used to slap my dick on that dude's wife's face, man, on a regular basis for like 2 years. Most men's ego can't handle that. So, moving on. Oh, one more thing about feedback. I had this woman. I'm assuming she's a woman. I don't know for a fact. It could have been a guy. Could have been a beta male guy. But I don't know if it's a woman. Some YouTube commenter named Incognito posted that he or she finds the contents of my video podcast to be very misogynistic. Man, y'all kill me with that fucking word, man. That has got to be the most overused fucking word in the 21st century. Misogynist. Most of you all don't know what a true misogynist is. And I'm going to have to break it down for like the billionth time. Here's the deal, man. For you ignorant people who don't know your terminology, don't do your research on terms. There's a difference between a sexist, a chauvinist, and a misogynist. There's a big difference. Sexist. If I'm sexist, what that means is I inherently believe that men are more intelligent than women. I believe that we're more worthy of the top-notch jobs than women are, that we're physically stronger than women are, and more specifically on a professional level, that if I, say, owned a company, I would tend to blatantly discriminate against women. Like, I either wouldn't hire women at all for any jobs, or I would only hire them for menial jobs like secretary positions. That's a sexist, okay? You got that? Get it? Got it? Good. That's a sexist. And by the way, footnote, a man and a woman can be a sexist. A lot of people tend to think when you hear the term sexist, that means that's only an exclusively male term. A woman can be sexist. Like, if you had a woman, a female judge, who was to say in a court that I believe women make better parents to children than men, that would make that female judge sexist. That's a sexist comment. And I know a lot of women who do believe that. They believe that women make better parents than men do. That's sexist. Get it? Got it good. The next similar term is chauvinist. Now, I'll openly admit, I've said this on Facebook. To one degree or another, I am a chauvinist. So that's one of the labels I never try to deny. I am chauvinistic. I think a lot of guys are chauvinistic. And this is where a lot of women confuse a chauvinist with a misogynist. A chauvinist is a man who believes that men should fulfill certain roles in a relationship and women should fulfill certain roles in a relationship and in society in general. For example, if I was to say, I believe that men should be the breadwinners in a marriage and the wives should stay at home, cook, clean, and take care of the children, that would be a chauvinistic statement. A woman can also be a chauvinist. If a woman was to say, well, even if I'm making more money than my husband, I think he should pay all the bills, given that he's the man and he's the husband. That's a chauvinistic statement on behalf of a woman. So both a man and a woman can be a chauvinist. Now, moving to the mother, there goes my nose. I don't know what it is when I do these video podcasts. It makes my nose itch. There's two terms, one used for predominantly men and one used for predominantly women. A misogynist and a misandrist. Now, I bet most of you men never heard the term misandrist, have you? That's because the media rarely uses the term misandrist. They're always throwing out that term misogynist, but you don't hear the media using the term misandrist. A misogynist is a man who passionately hates women, period. Get it? Got it? Good. Now, I must add, a woman can be a misogynist too. If you have a woman who hates her own gender, she is a misogynist. But the difference between sexist, chauvinist, and misogynist, sexist and chauvinist, they might criticize women from time to time. They might even insult women from time to time. They might exhibit behavior that women don't care for quite frequently. But the bottom line is they enjoy the company of women. And even more specifically, they like fucking women. A misogynist is a guy who hates women so much, he don't even want to be around women. I mean, literally, he doesn't even want to be around women. He don't even, for the most part, he don't even want to fuck women. He don't want shit to do with a woman. He entertains thoughts of killing women, of physically assaulting women, of torturing women. And if he was, say, to have sex with a woman, he would try to do something to, like, physically do, like, beat on her, choke her, slap the shit out of her. I mean, when you're a misogynist, you literally, I mean, literally, you hate women. You don't, you're not just agitated by women or women frustrate you from time to time. No, no, no. You hate women. You want to see them dead. Period. Like Jack the Ripper was a fucking misogynist. Ted Bundy, look him up, a notorious serial killer of women. He was a misogynist. When you're a misogynist, that means you either do tend to kill women, or at minimum, you entertain the thought of killing them and torturing them and doing that type of shit. That's a misogynist. Like women say, well, if a man calls women bitches, he's a misogynist. No, he's not. If you, again, if a man enjoys dating women, enjoys fucking women, he ain't no misogynist. He might be a chauvinist and or a sexist, but he ain't no, he is no misogynist. Now, the female equivalent to that is a misandrist. A misandrist is a woman who has a passionate hatred for men. And there are a lot of misandrists in this society. Again, and also side note on that, a man can be a misandrist. If a man hates members of his own gender, he is a misandrist. But yeah, a lot of women are misandrists. They hate men. They want to see men dead. They don't want anything to do with men. So get your terms right. Marriage and monogamy. I want to touch on that real briefly. I only got about 20 minutes, so I got to move through some shit real quick. Here's a Marriage, a History by Stephanie Coots. This is a good book. This is a good book right here. It's a really lengthy, detailed book, so I'm not going to spend too much time talking about the contents of that book, but I'll give you the gist of it. Here's what a lot of people don't realize about marriage. And why I wanted to talk about this is because some of the feedback I got, particularly from women, a lot of women were asking me my thoughts on marriage. Alan, why haven't you been married? Alan, what are you anti-marriage? Alan, I think you're anti-monogamy and blah, 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 blah. Number one, I'm not married. Never been married. Never proposed marriage to a woman, not once in my life. So there's my background related to marriage. Came close a couple times. There's been at least two women in my life I entertained the thought of proposing marriage to. One was my college sweetheart, and one was probably about 8 years ago, 7-8 years ago. But other than that, no, I've never been married, never proposed marriage. A lot of people think that marriage is that's been around since the beginning of time, since the beginning of human beings' existence on earth. And what Stephanie Coons breaks down in that book is that when you examine the length of the earth and for the billions of years that human beings have walked the face of the earth, marriage and monogamy, believe it or not, is a fairly new concept. again, in the big scheme, let's say that, I don't know the exact, if anybody knows, I don't know, I would have to do my research. I don't know the exact number of years that the Earth has been in existence, and specifically human beings on Earth. I want to say it's at least a billion years. Marriage and monogamy has only been fairly popular, I want to say, only going back, I want to say 5,000 years at best. I would have to do my research, but anyway, that's what Stephanie Coles breaks down. Say, originally, almost everybody on Earth was promiscuous and polyamorous. There was a time you didn't have no wedding ceremonies. Like, if you read the Christian Bible, again, I'm not the most religious person in the world, but I used to be. I'm more so spiritual now. But if you read the Christian Bible, they don't talk about, like, wedding ceremonies. In the Christian Bible, they believe that once you had sex with a woman, you were married to her. You know, once you had exchanged vows and had sex, you were married. Wasn't no, like, big extravagant ceremony. But even the marriage back in the day, even a lot of guys who were married, it was polygamous marriage. It was polygamy. You know, there's countries and cultures to this day where polygamy is still legal. Now, bigamy and polygamy is not legal in America, so that's why you have a lot of polyamorous relationships. Polyamory is almost like the unmarried equivalent to polygamy. But yeah, like, I tell you, speaking of the Christian Bible, who was a biblical pimp, Solomon. You familiar with Solomon? There's a character in the Bible named Solomon. He had 700 wives and 300 concubines. Remember in the very last video podcast, I was talking about concubines? To refresh your memory, a concubine is when a married man has an additional lover that his wife knows about. So, like, basically an openly known mistress. That's a concubine. So, like, even in today's society, there's men who have concubines. If there's a guy who's married and his wife is living with him and he got one or two other women living with him that he's fucking. Like, there's a celebrity I met when I lived in Los Angeles. I'm not going to say his name, but he's not super well-known, but he's kind of middle of the pack well-known. But me and him were rapping, and he had that situation going on. He was living with his wife, his ex-girlfriend, and his ex-girlfriend's cousin, and he was fucking all three of them. And I was like, damn, brother, you got it going on, man. And he was like, yeah, man, that's how I roll. But yeah, see, that would be an example of a man that's married with two concubines. Yeah, he was living with his wife, the woman he dated right before his wife, his ex-girlfriend before his wife, and he was dating, and he was fucking his ex-girlfriend's cousin. They were all living together. So that's, but yeah, going back to Solomon, Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines. He was a biblical pimp, man. I don't believe in obligatory monogamy. I say that if you've read or listened to the audiobook version of my book, The Beta Male Revolution. I don't believe in obligatory monogamy. I believe in what's known as natural monogamy. What's the difference? Obligatory monogamy is when you are promising monogamy to someone because that you're companion or spouse is making you feel obligated to, or you feel, because of your morals and values, you feel like you're supposed to be monogamous. That's obligatory monogamy, excuse me. Again, dragon fruit, man. My man Black Euro Strikes turned me on to this, so I'm gonna add this to my list of my favorite flavors. Yeah, I don't believe in being monogamous to any woman because I feel like I have to be or I should be. Fuck that. I don't roll like that. Natural monogamy, plain and simply, is when a man or a woman choose on their own volition, they choose to be monogamous to someone. Like, for example, if I'm messing around with three different women, and each of those three women I'm messing around with says, Alan, we don't want to fuck another guy. We only want to fuck you. And I even tell them, I say, hey, no, y'all got the freedom to fuck other guys. They say, no, we want to just fuck you. Then that would be natural monogamy. They're choosing to be monogamous. And I've had that situation with some women. I've had women that I never obligated them to be monogamous with me, but they chose on their own to be monogamous with me. And there's been at least a couple women in my life, I've done the same thing. Yeah, there's been at least, for me, probably at least three or four women in my life, if only for a period of weeks or months, that I chose to be monogamous with them on my own. Nobody pressured me to, no one obligated me to. I chose on my own to be monogamous with them. That's the only monogamy I believe in. Again, is natural monogamy. But I never promise any woman any type of obligatory monogamy. I think the shit's unrealistic in most cases, to keep it real, man. You know, like, a lot of women associate love with monogamy. And I'm going to go against the grain of conventional society wisdom. And I know I'll get a lot of feedback from women on this assertion, but I'm going to tell you something. I think monogamy is bullshit. I think it's a social construct. What is a social construct? Most older guys know what that term means, but a lot of younger guys might not know. Remember I always talk about social programming? Social programming, stuff that people feed you to believe is true and valid, that's not necessarily true or valid. Well, that's basically what it relates to a social construct. Social construct is stuff that ain't got nothing to do with the natural earth or your core self. In other words, does a man or woman come out of the womb desiring monogamy, or does society brainwash you to believe monogamy is a good thing? Marinate on that for a few seconds. Remember I mentioned Daniel Bergner's book, What Women Want? How he does, he either did a lot of experiments and surveys and studies himself, or he kind of tailed along with other people like sexologists and psychiatrists who were doing studies. Oh, I got one to talk about if I have the time. The wet-o-meter. You got to read about the wet-o-meter in Daniel Bergner's book. But anyway, that's one of the things that Daniel Bergner asserts in his book. He says there's been this long-standing belief that women are more prudish than men and women are more monogamy-oriented men. He said that there's no biological evidence that backs that up. There's no scientific or biological evidence that backs that up. Women lean towards monogamy because society tells them to. You know what my take is? This is my speculative take on why monogamy start being. Because if society didn't promote monogamy, womanizing alpha males would monopolize all the women. I say that in, I think, the Beta Male Revolution. It's the truth, man. I mean, that's, dude, it's just like, I remember I was on Facebook one time, and this lesbian blogger, I don't think I follow her anymore, but this is years ago, this is probably 5-6 years ago. There was this lesbian blogger that some of my Facebook friends used to follow, because she would always post a lot of strong opinions and commentary about stuff. And she said something that was so true, man, that I co-signed with it. I can't remember exact words, so I'm going to be paraphrasing, but she essentially said, beta males should be so happy that there's things called money and material possessions. Because she said if there was no such thing as money and material possessions, she said y'all beta males would never get laid. She said only alpha males would be getting laid. I agree with that. Well, actually, she said alpha males and lesbians. That's what she actually said. She said alpha males and lesbians. But to a large degree, I believe that, man. I believe that's why society promotes marriage and monogamy, man. It's a way of evenly distributing out female companionship to guys who otherwise would, dude. Let me tell you guys something. I'm coming down to my last 7 to 8 minutes. A lot of you guys out here believe that money and material possessions is the number one key to pulling women. And that could be so much further from the truth. Remember that 2 episodes ago, I was talking about how I've been a woman's other man at least 35 to 40 times in my life? Like, I was the man that a woman was having sex with while she was cheating on her husband, her fiance, or her long-term boyfriend. Do you know at least a good percentage? I would say of all the women who I was the other man, I would say at least no less than 25% of those women had husbands, fiancés, or boyfriends who was making way more money than me. Like, way. I've told this story a million times when I did my blog talk radio show. There was this one woman when I lived in Los Angeles. She was beautiful blonde. She was Caucasian. Used to drive a Porsche 911. Man, her fiance, he was like either a millionaire or close to being a millionaire. He like owned some kind of computer software company or something. Yeah, man. And at the time, shit, I think I was making like 30, 35 grand a year, dude. So if money was the number one key to pulling women, how would I be able to fuck this woman when her fiance is a millionaire? Why would she be giving me attention if money was the number one key to pulling women? Because it's not. Money makes your non-sexual companionship more appealing. Remember that. Remember that. I wrote an article on the Negro Manosphere. Shout out to O'Shea Duke Jackson. I wrote an article on the Negro Manosphere where I talked about that both men, if there's one mistake that both men and women make, is either overestimating the appeal of their non-sexual companionship. That's usually women. And men sometimes make the mistake of overestimating the appeal of their sexual companionship. Dude, there's a lot of things that will make you more attractive to a woman non-sexually. I mentioned them at the very end of my very last video podcast. If you're flattering, if you're entertaining, if you're financially generous, if you're helpful and accommodating, and if you're emotionally empathetic, all those 5 things will make you more appealing to women non-sexually. Sexually, you need to be confident. You need to be kinky. You need to be erotically dominant. Extra emphasis on that. You need to be erotically dominant. Go listen to my audiobook, Who Said Again. Listen to Verbal Seduction Story Number 1. Really listen to all 6 of them, but listen particularly to Verbal Seduction Story Number 1. You'll see where the turning point was when I seduced that woman. Verbal Seduction Story Number 1 represents the first time in my life that I had ever had sex with a woman the same day I met her. Before that, I had never had sex with a woman the same day I met her. At the earliest I think I had ever had sex with a woman before Verbal Seduction Story Number 1 was maybe the 2nd day after I met a woman. But the first time I ever had sex with a woman, the first day I met her, was the story I talk about in Verbal Seduction Story Number 1. And the turning point, without getting into lengthy detail, was when I exerted my erotic dominance. Confident, kinky, erotically dominant, and egotistically indifferent. If you've read Mo 1, you know what that term means. Egotistical indifference. That's another way of saying thick skin. You don't give a fuck what other people think. You don't give a fuck what other people think. Let me see. Anything else? I got only about 4 minutes. Well, I'll wrap it up with this. there's only really five ways to have non-relationship sex or casual sex with a woman. Only really five ways. And that's with your physical appearance, to be wealthy and or famous, to have exceptional verbal communication skills and verbal seduction skills, to lie to women and manipulate their emotions, or to get them drugged, get them drunk, and then take advantage of them, or forcibly rape them, or forcibly date rape them. That's the only ways you're going to have sex with a woman without being that woman's husband, fiance, long-term boyfriend. Is one of those five ways. Let's start with number one, physical appearance. There's some guys, man, that can just get pussy just because they're just amazingly good looking, period. I mean, that's just real talk. You know, that's the type of guy, he don't really have to say shit to a woman. He could just walk into a room and he's going to have two or three women just throwing the pussy at him. Because he either got an exceptionally handsome face and even more so an exceptionally great physique. Because women, studies have shown, women don't put as much emphasis on facial looks as men do. But they definitely, trust me when I say this, women pay attention to physiques. So when it comes to your looks from the neck on down, women pay attention to that shit. Don't ever let no woman fool you and think that she don't pay attention to looks. Matter of fact, Match.com did a survey about that. That they did a survey where they found that women put at minimum just as much emphasis, if not more emphasis, on a man's looks from the neck on down than men do on women. I found that a little bit surprising. Believe it or not, in other words, women are more critical of fat, chunky men than men are of fat, a man when he's really horny and desperate for sex. He'll fuck a woman who's like 30, 40 pounds overweight. But most women, according to this survey, said they didn't want to fuck a real chunky guy. They pay attention to it. So that's the number one way you're going to get casual sex pretty easily. If you're just a really good looking guy. Again, I would say generally both face and body, but at minimum, body. Second, if you like some kind of rich, famous celebrity, you know, again, the wealth and material possessions is going to attract women because women like to live an extravagant lifestyle. Then they may not necessarily even be attracted to you physically, but they just want to have access to that upgraded lifestyle. And as far as fame, that helps out a lot of guys because women follow suit by what other women do. I mentioned that a number of times on my Blog Talk Radio show. If women see other women being attracted to you and finding you desirable, they're going to find you more desirable. That's what a lot of pickup artists call social proof. What else? Verbal communication skills. Verbal communication skills. See, that's my number one area of expertise. Matter of fact, there was this one episode of Obsidian show where I think he had Ron Wills and Black Gnostic Speaks on his show, and they were talking about the four cornerstones of game. And I can't, to be truthful, I can't even remember all four of the cornerstones. I think I can remember at least two of them. One was what's called the trap, how you capture a woman's attention and interest to begin with, to even make her just interested enough and enthusiastic enough to even want to engage in conversation with you. That would be something such as your looks, what I was just talking about, your looks, your clothing, maybe even the type of car you drive, that type of thing. And then the second one was the mouthpiece. Now, this was funny, man, because this brother, he gave me... there was this one brother gave me what I call accomplicism. What is accomplicism? Accomplicism is my unique term for a blend of a compliment and a criticism. And his brother who called an Obsidian show when Ron Wills and Black Gnostics was talking about the four cornerstones of game, when they got on the subject of mouthpiece, this young brother, bless his heart, he said, here was his criticism. He said, hey, man, I'm sure y'all brothers know about Alan Roger Curry. And, of course, everybody's like, yeah, we know Alan Roger Curry. He said, man, Alan Roger Curry, he ain't the most handsome, smooth-looking brother in the world. And I kind of lightheartedly took offense to that, man. It's like he was trying to say I wasn't a good-looking brother, man. I like to think I'm a handsome brother. But anyway, no, I wasn't offended by that. But he said, you know, Alan, man, you know, he's an older guy. He ain't the smoothest-looking brother. But he said, damn, man, that motherfucker got a mouthpiece, man. He knows how to talk shit to women, man. He know how to talk dirty to women. And, you know, all the brothers gave me my dap and said, yeah, oh, yeah, man, Alan's. I mean, I didn't earn that nickname I got, the king of verbal seduction, for nothing, man. I mean, I'm just keeping it real, man. That nickname didn't just come out of nowhere. Matter of fact, I mentioned in a previous podcast, a woman who I used to mess around with, her and her two girlfriends gave me that nickname when I used to live in California. But yeah, so out of their four quarters, I can't even remember the other three other than the one, the trapping, but, oh, I think one of the other three cornerstones of the game was you got to be adaptable to different environments, like be able to talk to a woman at a funeral versus the beach versus in class at school. You got to be able to change up your conversation style depending on what social environment you're in. I think that was one of the other cornerstones of their game, four cornerstones of the game. But yeah, the biggest one out of the four they mentioned that I'm known for is verbal communication skills, and more specifically, verbal seduction skills. And as far as when I was talking about, there's only five ways to get women to have casual sex with you. If you're not necessarily amazingly good looking, if you don't have a lot of wealth or fame, and if you're not willing to lie to women, deceive women, mislead women, manipulate their emotions, the only thing that leaves is you gotta be a skilled conversationalist. And that's what I am, and that's what I teach other guys to be. I can't tell you how many women I've fucked in my life that told me that, Alan, if it wasn't for your talk dirty skills, I've had either one or two things. Women say they either wouldn't have had sex with me, period, or they definitely wouldn't have had sex with me as quickly as they did if it wasn't for my erotic dirty talk skills. Yeah, so that's the third most significant way you're going to get a woman in bed casually. Fourth way is what a lot of pickup artists teach, which is lying to women, making a woman feel like you're willing to be her next long-term boyfriend, and then after you get the pussy, you just dump the woman. See, I ain't down with that shit, man. I know a lot of pickup artists promote that and encourage that. Nah, man, I wrote an article in the Negro Manosphere called There Are Ethics to Getting Laid. Matter of fact, that's one of my most popular articles on there, is Yes, There Are Ethics to Getting Laid. I don't believe in lying to women to get the pussy. I know a lot of guys disagree with me on that. I've had a lot of them tell me. They said, man, Alan, I'm sorry, man. I'll lie to a bitch in a moment to get the pussy. But, yeah, number one, I'm not going to lie to a woman and make a woman think that I want a long-term monogamous relationship with her when I know I'm interested in short-term non-monogamous sex. I won't do it. I won't make a woman think I want to be her future husband or her next long-term boyfriend just to get some pussy. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to tell a woman I love her just to get some pussy. I'm not going to do that shit, man. I think that shit's foul. I don't encourage that shit at all. That's what Mole 1 is all about, man. Mole 1 is about getting pussy by being upfront, specific, and straightforwardly honest about your desires, interests, and intentions. So no, man, I ain't going to try to manipulate a woman's emotions just to get some pussy. I will not do that. That's where I have some scruples and some ethics. And again, the final way, the most deplorable way to get pussy is to rape a woman, date rape a woman, or get her drunk, or put drugs in her system and then take advantage of her. Man, dude, if somebody did that to a female relative of mine, man, they better hope I don't find their ass before the police do. Dude, if I had a daughter, I don't have a daughter, but if somebody got my daughter drunk or drugged her up, and then, dude, I would unleash all kinds of hell on your ass. Dude, I would get medieval on your ass, as they say. I don't, dude, I ain't down with none of that shit. The rape, date rape, sexual assault shit. No, that's funky foul. So that's going to be it for video podcast number 6. I probably won't do another video podcast the remainder of this week. My next one will probably be recorded either Sunday or Monday of next week. Sunday or Monday of next week. Until then, the hashtag for this video podcast is money is overrated. Money is overrated. That's the hashtag. Money is overrated. Enjoy the rest of your Tuesday, April 18th, and enjoy the rest of your week. I am out.
Yes, sir.
Say it again.
Yes, sir.
Who's the king?
Alan, you're the king.
Say it again.
Alan, you're the king. You're dominating me.
Say it again.
Alan, you're dominating me right now. Mode 1.
You're the king, Alan.